157th ordinary period of sessions of the Inter-American Commission. Very pleased to be here. Okay. Working on the translation, the interpretation here for my colleague. We're going to proceed with the following audience, which is a hearing as a follow-up ex officio on the report, Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women in British Columbia, Canada. There will be presentations from three parties, and I will announce the delegations of each of the parties in the order in which they will be presenting. First, we'll hear from civil society representatives for a period of 15 minutes. We have with us today, we're very pleased, the United Nations Rapporteur, Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, Ms. Dubravka Simonovic. And we have the state, who will have a period of 25 minutes. Civil society, represented by Ms. Sheila Day, Sharon McIvor, Angela Cameron, Mavis Erickson, Dawn Harvard, and Joyce McDougall, I understand, are present. I've mentioned the Special Rapporteur. And the Canadian delegation, which is headed by Ms. Margaret Buist, the Director General, Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women Pre-Inquiry Secretariat, Indigenous and Northern Affairs Canada, Her Excellency the Ambassador, Jennifer May Alice-Lotin, the Permanent Representative of Canada to the OAS, Ms. Jolene Head, the Director, Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women Pre-Inquiry Secretariat, Indigenous and Northern Affairs Canada, and Monsieur Jean-Luc Bilon, First Secretary, Alternate Representative of the Permanent Mission of Canada to the United States. I'm joined on the table, I'm James Cavallaro, President of the Commission, Rapporteur for Canada, and I'm joined on this panel by my colleagues, Commissioner Francisco Guiguren, First Vice President of the Commission, Commissioner Margaret May McCauley, Second Vice President of the Commission, Commissioner Enrique Gil Botero, and also Assistant Executive Secretary Elizabeth Abbey Merched. Without more, let us proceed, if we may, with the times that have been allotted. The first period is 15 minutes, and I will try and hold you to this, and I will give you warnings when we reach 5, 3, and 1 minute. 15 minutes to the representatives of civil society, and I request, please, that you identify yourself before making use of the microphone. Thank you so much. Pardon, we're just having a bit of a technical difficulty with Commissioner Guiguren's interpretation device, and we're going to try and fix that. If you just hold off for 1 second. The clock is not running, not to worry. Now it is running.
Thank you, Commissioners, for initiating this hearing. My name is Dawn Lavelle Harvard. I'm President of the Native Women's Association of Canada and a member of the Wequemecong First Nation. With me are Sharon McIvor, who is Thompson Indian and a member of the Lower Nicola Valley Band, and Sheila Day, both from the Canadian Feminist Alliance for International Action, as well as Mavis Erickson from the Codsley, who is an expert on the Highway of Tears issues in northern BC. NWAC and FAFSA applied for thematic briefings on the murders and disappearances of Indigenous women and girls in British Columbia and in Canada in 2012 and 2013. We are gratified by the Commission's attention to the ongoing human rights crisis in Canada. Although we have hope with the recent change in government, Canada has barely made a beginning on the strategic, long-term, transformative work that is needed to protect the lives of Indigenous women and girls and stop the violence. Today, we wish to provide a focused briefing on action and inaction in response to the Inter-American Commission report. First of all, the Inter-American Commission indicated that full implementation of the 63 recommendations of BC's OPAL inquiry would be a start on fulfilling the province's and Canada's obligations to act with due diligence to prevent and remedy the violence against Indigenous women and girls. The implementation of the OPAL recommendations by the province of British Columbia has been wholly inadequate. Here are the things the province has done. One, provided additional money to the WISH drop-in center, although there is still no 24-hour drop-in center as recommended. set up a fund that will pay $50,000 to children of victims identified in the OPAL report if they apply and qualify. 3, introduced a new Missing Persons Act giving new powers to the police to obtain information. 4, provided some short-term funding for community programs. 5, made some changes to the Crown Policy Manual regarding supporting victims and witnesses who have substance dependency or are engaged in prostitution. 6, created provincial policing standards on missing persons investigations. 7, announced an investment of $1.6 million over 3 years for new transportation measures along the Highway of Tears. However, 10 years after the community-led Highway of Tears symposium, Indigenous women and girls who travel along this highway for work, school, or to obtain medical care still have few options but to hitchhike. 8, they've convened a family gathering in February 2016, permitting family members to tell their stories to the ministers of justice, as well as community and social development. These are important first steps, but these steps are, in some cases, only a partial response to the recommendations that were made. We are concerned that implementation of many recommendations regarding police training, standards, equality audits, and the structure and funding of police services are said by the police to be underway or in progress. There is no way of knowing what this means, what is being done or not done. The province considers its public reporting on the implementation of the OPAL recommendations to be at an end as of its final report in December 2014. We note with concern that the province's Advisory Committee on Provincial Policing Standards, which has work underway on non-discriminatory standards for policing, includes no women's organizations. In short, the problem here is that there are no apparent plans in place that are measurable and transparent to deal with the recommended changes. Instead, we have patchy implementation, bits of money, and opaqueness. OPAL recommended the appointment of an independent advisor on the implementation of the recommendations, but in effect, there has been no mechanism for overseeing the implementation of these recommendations and no effective liaison between the government and civil society. This is a crucial point. We believe it is because of the opaqueness and the wholly inadequate implementation of the OPAL recommendations that the Auditor General of British Columbia has decided to undertake an audit of the implementation of 23 of the OPAL recommendations. When civil society groups asked for a transparent mechanism to oversee the implementation of both the OPAL and the Inter-American Commission recommendations, Minister Justice Anton of BC replied, and I quote, "British Columbia has contributed to Canada's formal response on the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights report, thus no further response is contemplated at this time." The recommendations of this commission went far beyond those of the OPAL Commission, clarifying for British Columbia and Canada their obligations to deal with the root causes of the violence against Indigenous women and girls, and stressing that addressing violence against Indigenous women is not sufficient unless the underlying factors of racial and gender discrimination and the impacts of Canada's colonial history are addressed. This commission recommended that Canada and British Columbia provide a national coordinated response to address the social and economic factors that prevent Indigenous women from enjoying their human rights, design and implement better coordination among the different levels and sectors of government, establish strengthened accountability mechanisms for police and prosecutions, provide access to legal aid and support services for families of missing or murdered Indigenous women, ensure active participation of Indigenous women in the design and implementation of initiatives that affect them, develop data systems that collect accurate statistics on missing and murdered Indigenous women, improve its consultation mechanisms with the different parties involved, including Indigenous women, Indigenous women's groups, civil society organizations, and the families of the missing women, to eliminate the sex discrimination from the Indian Act, and create a national level action plan or nationwide inquiry in consultation with Indigenous women at all stages from conception to establishing terms of reference, implementation, and evaluation. These recommendations have not been acted upon by either level of government, with one crucial exception. We do congratulate the newly elected Liberal government for initiating a national inquiry into the murders and disappearances of Indigenous women and girls. Clearly, this is a big step forward to address the human rights crisis before us. One of the things that concerns us most at the moment is the focus of the inquiry. It is clear from pre-inquiry consultations that the federal ministers tasked with responsibility for designing the inquiry wish to ensure that the family members of murdered and missing women will have safe spaces in which to be heard, and that the inquiry will result in their having access to the information, healing, and reparations to which they are entitled. This is most welcome. However, it is not as clear that the inquiry will be focused on the racialized and sexualized violence against Indigenous women and girls that is perpetrated by both Indigenous and non-Indigenous men and by representatives of the state. We say this because this has had a lesser place in the public narrative during the pre-inquiry consultation period. It is difficult for Canada, for the public, for governments, for Aboriginal people, and indeed for non-Aboriginal people to stare into the reality of brutal, sexualized, racialized male violence that Indigenous women and girls are facing and that we are trying to stop. As advocates for Indigenous women, we feel compelled to say it again and again because it can be easily obscured as it has been for decades. We need to know that we continue to have the support of human rights experts like this commission when asking our government to stare into the face of this deeply rooted discrimination and not seek ways to look away. We need to know that the inquiry will address the full dimensions of social and economic marginalization of Indigenous women and girls and willingly scrutinize the ways in which government policies and programs and government omissions exacerbate and reinforce our marginalization. Thank you.
My name is Sharon McIver. Indigenous women have been marginalized in decision-making processes regarding our lives, not only by the Government of Canada, but also by the male-led Aboriginal organizations. This has occurred repeatedly over decades. This happened specifically in the late 60s when our women fought to eliminate the sex discrimination in the Indian Act. The male-led organizations opposed our being treated as equals as they stood with the government against our women and against our people. Male-led organizations also opposed equality rights for Indigenous women being included in Canada's new constitution. And again, both Canada and the male-led organization opposed NWAC's legal challenge for a seat at the table when the constitution was being negotiated. NWAC finally was recognized as one of Canada's national Aboriginal organizations in 1992. But in the spring of 2016, in collaboration with the Assembly of First Nations, the new Liberal government arbitrarily began excluding NWAC from national meetings on key issues impacting our people. Now we are at a critical moment in the struggle for equality and the recognition of basic human rights for Indigenous women and girls. We have no confidence that our interests, concerns, equality, and human rights will take center place or that we will even be treated as key participants in the process. NWAC and FAFIA have been engaged with this issue for many years. Based on the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous People, we believe we are entitled to full engagement with the Government of Canada on the terms of reference, the design of the inquiry, and the Indigenous women, and that Indigenous women have a right to free, prior, and informed consent to decisions that affect our lives and impact our ability to exercise our basic human rights. Another major concern is whether this inquiry will be a federal or a national inquiry. There is broad agreement on the need for a comprehensive national inquiry that can examine the action of police and government institutions in federal, provincial, and territorial jurisdictions and design a national action plan that will coordinate actions at all levels of government. This commission and the UN CEDAW committee have stressed that failures to coordinate among the institution, among police forces, and between levels of government have contributed to the increased risk of violence faced by Indigenous women and girls and results in the violation of Article 3 of the CEDAW Convention. The provinces and territories have publicly supported the national inquiry and agreed to full cooperation and participation. But with all due respect, vague expressions of goodwill are not sufficient in these circumstances. We submit that the Government of Canada should be entering into legal agreements that explicitly set out the terms of participation with each province and territory before the inquiry begins, thereby ensuring the inquiry can scrutinize conduct policies and laws in provincial and territorial jurisdiction. A human rights framework must be incorporated into the mandate of the national inquiry. This commission and the CEDAW committee have already issued reports on the murders and disappearances of Indigenous women and girls, with recommendations that should be implemented now rather than waiting for the completion of the inquiry, recommendations like removing the sex discrimination from the Indian Act. Canada's attitude towards its human rights obligations under international human rights law is, we are sorry to say, far from clear. While the new Liberal government has stated that it wishes to engage with the United Nations, and after a decade of Harper disdain, we celebrate that. However, Canada seems to accept the recommendations from this commission and the CEDAW committee as good advice from knowledgeable people, but with no legal or obligatory status beyond that. We note Canada's objection to the jurisdiction of this commission is set out in paragraph 106 of the commission's report. We'd like to know whether this still reflects the view of Canada or whether it was the view of the previous administration. Consequently, here are our additional questions and requests. One, does Canada intend to implement all of the recommendations of the Inter-America Commission? How will it do that, and how will Indigenous women and civil society organizations be able to participate in that implementation? To ensure that we avoid the mistakes of the Missing Women Commission of Inquiry in BC, will Canada publish draft terms of reference for the inquiry in advance so that Indigenous women, our organizations, and civil society organizations can comment on the design and scope of the inquiry before it begins? What steps will Canada take to make sure that this is a national inquiry? Will Canada continue its pre-inquiry consultations by convening a face-to-face meeting for NWAC and FAFIA with the ministers and with women's anti-violence organizations before finalizing the mandate and terms of reference for the inquiry? Of the Inter-America Commission on Human Rights, we request that the Commission stay engaged in dialogue with Canada throughout the national inquiry period and continue to scrutinize implementation of Canada's obligations. We believe that there are many ways in which the Commission can assist Canada and the inquiry. And we also request that the Commission urge Canada and British Columbia to begin to implement the Inter-America Commission on Human Rights recommendations immediately and establish a monitoring mechanism so this process is transparent and civil society groups can participate. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And it's a pleasure to see you again. It's a pleasure to have you here, Madam Special Rapporteur, Dubravka Simonovic. We'd like to offer you 10 minutes for an initial presentation.
Thank you. Honorable members of the Commission, distinguished representatives of the State of Canada, dear members of civil society, and all others present in this room, I would like to thank the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights for inviting me as an independent United Nations Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, Its Causes and Consequences, to participate at this hearing regarding the follow-up on the Commission's report, Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women in British Columbia, Canada. I am appearing at this hearing on a voluntary basis without prejudice to the privileges and immunities of the United Nations pursuant to 1946 UN Convention on Privileges and Immunities, pursuant to United Nations Human Rights Council Resolution 2325. I act under the aegis of Human Rights Council without remuneration as an independent expert within the scope of my mandate. It is my first appearance before this commission, and I hope that this is a start of a fruitful cooperation between global mechanisms like Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women and regional mechanisms like Commission dealing with same topics. It is also an honor and privilege for me to share my work and thoughts with you today on the topic of this inquiry. I would like to address two main issues from the angle of my mandate. First one is complementarity of the international and regional human rights standards, which the State of Canada should bear in mind when adopting steps to comply with the recommendations issued by the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, and prevention on femicides in the context of discrimination against Aboriginal women in Canada. Let me start by mentioning that prior to my appointment as United Nations Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, I was for a period of 12 years an expert in the UN CEDAW committee. I was there when the committee examined the combined 6th and 7th periodic report of Canada in October 2008 and started with the follow-up procedure and later on carried an inquiry in situ and adopted its inquiry report on murdered and missing Aboriginal women in Canada. The report of the CEDAW inquiry is now under the follow-up or implementation procedure, like this Inter-American Commission's report on murdered and missing Indigenous women in British Columbia that we are discussing today. For that reason, I would like to stress the compatibility and converging tracks of global and regional human rights instruments, like the two covenants on civil and political rights and covenant on economic, social, and cultural rights, the CEDAW Convention and its General Recommendation Number 19 on Violence Against Women, the Declaration on Violence Against Women, and United Nations Declaration on Rights of Indigenous People, and also regional human rights instruments, like Charter of the American, like the OIS Charter and the American Declaration on the Rights of Man. They all jointly provide a source of legal obligation of state and due diligence obligation of Canada to protect, prevent, investigate, prosecute, and remedy violence against Indigenous women and girls. Two different monitoring mechanisms, i.e. Inter-American Commission on Human Rights and United Nations Committee on the Elimination of Discrimination Against Women, conducted investigations in Canada into murders and disappearances of Indigenous women and girls and issued reports. The CEDAW Committee found that Canada's failure to take adequate action to address the violence was a grave violation of rights contained in CEDAW Convention and adopted 38 recommendations and also recommended setting up of a national inquiry. The Inter-American Commission on Human Rights approved its thematic report on missing and murdered Indigenous women in British Columbia, Canada, and issued recommendations. Although this commission chose to focus on situation in British Columbia because of the number of missing and murdered Indigenous women was higher there in absolute terms, information received by the commission indicated that this could be a nationwide phenomenon. For that reason, the commission recommended creation of a national-level plan or a nationwide inquiry. So we are seeing that those recommendations are going in the same direction. Above mentioned global and regional instruments, as accepted international legally binding obligations of the State of Canada, provide a human rights framework for national inquiry, while specific recommendations coming from the Commission and CEDAW reports are also providing a roadmap of measures that should be undertaken. Comparison of those measures shows that majority of them could be implemented jointly through national inquiry, while some other measures should be implemented also jointly, but separately from that inquiry that was already mentioned, because they are of such nature that could be implemented immediately, like the one on the elimination of all remaining sex discrimination provisions from the Indian Act that are contrary to the international women's human rights norms. Since the publication of both reports, Canada has undergone a federal election in December, and the new government announced that it would hold a national inquiry into murders and disappearances of Indigenous women and girls in Canada. I hope that today we will hear new information about steps undertaken and progress achieved. It is important to see that both reports found that disappearances and murders of Indigenous women and girls in Canada are part of a broader pattern of violence and discrimination against Indigenous women in the country, which exists within a historical context that includes the colonization process, the disposition of traditional territories, the imposition of unjust laws and policies, the residential school legacy, as well as intersection between racism, sexism, and poverty. They also found a huge problem related to harmful stereotyping and entrenched layers of discrimination that were applied by state officials without even noting that those stereotypes are harmful stereotypes. In my capacity as a Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, in January this year, I have participated at a symposium organized in Ottawa by non-governmental organizations present here and some others on murders and disappearances of Indigenous women in girls in Canada, planning for change. And it is important to mention that I have participated jointly with other United Nations experts and experts from this commission. I would like to mention that six different experts participated. It was UN Special Rapporteur on Rights on Indigenous People, Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, UN Special Rapporteur on Right to Adequate Housing, two CEDAW experts, one of them who visited the country in the scope of that inquiry, the other one that is following up on current recommendations, and the currently present chairperson of this committee, James Cavallaro, Chair of Inter-American Commission on Human Rights. After that meeting, we have adopted the joint statement with specific recommendations related to this inquiry, and later on we had a meeting with three ministers from the Government of Canada to discuss those recommendations. I would like to mention that the international human rights experts expressed the view that the meeting with the Canadian government could lead to the new approach toward Indigenous women in Canada, and the inquiry could stand as a model human rights procedure internationally. So we all are looking forward into really implementation of all those recommendations. Finally, I would like to briefly mention the issue of femicide. As a UN Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, on International Day for the Elimination of Violence Against Women, 25th November 2015, I have called all United Nations member states to establish a femicide watch, or watch of gender-related killings of women and girls. And it is important to know that currently all states have data on homicides, but they do not have data on femicides. And in the future, it would be important to have comparable public data on femicides as a first step. But the second step would be to use such data as a preventive tool, to see how to use that data as preventive tool is another important thing that I am proposing. I am proposing for each country to establish a mechanism that will analyze data, that would go into each and every case of murder of women and girls that is gender-related, and to look what was missed. What was missed by police forces, what was missed by prosecution, what was missed by those that were helping those victims of violence, in order to see what are patterns there, what should be done in the future to prevent preventable death, what was with prosecution, what was with impunity, and so on. And with such data, we could focus on real prevention, because those data and analysis of data could be based on actual problems in the country. With respect to Indigenous women, it would be important to focus on specific race and ethnicity connections, and to see how in context of Indigenous women, Canada could look at femicide watch on Indigenous women and girls as a specific femicide watch that would create opportunity for all those involved to focus on the future, not only to remedy the past, which is very important, but to focus in the future and to prevent such cases for all generations living now in Canada of Indigenous women and girls. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Madam Special Rapporteur. Let me offer the floor to the delegation of the State of Canada for 25 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Cavallo, and good afternoon to you all. My name is Jennifer Lowton, and I'm Canada's ambassador to the OAS. First of all, I'd like to thank the commissioners and the commission for providing this space for this very important dialogue and this very important public engagement on this issue, which Canada takes very seriously. I'd also like to thank the representatives of Indigenous communities and civil society from Canada for being here with us today and for the leadership that they have always shown on this issue. The Government of Canada looks forward to working with them going forward as we continue to address this issue. I'd like to thank also the Special Rapporteur on Violence Against Women, who helps to put this issue into a global context, which I think is extremely important in remembering that these issues happen not just in Canada, but all over the world, and we are all committed to a global solution to the challenge of violence against women. And finally, before I turn the floor over to Margaret Buist, and to Jolene Head. Margaret Biostu is the Director General of the Pre-Inquiry on Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women, and Jolene Head, who is the Director of the Pre-Inquiry on Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women from Indian and Northern Affairs in Canada. I would like to say that as Canada's first woman ambassador before the OAS, I very deeply and personally share the hope that the welcome announcement of a national inquiry on missing and murdered Indigenous women does lead to a future in Canada that heals the wounds of the past, and more importantly, as you have said, creates a future where there's space for all, room for dialogue and participation in safety and in the full enjoyment of human rights. With those brief words of introduction, I'd like now to turn the microphone over to Margaret Buist, who is the Director General, as I said, of the Missing and Murdered Indigenous Women Pre-Inquiry Secretariat.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. Thank you, Commissioners. Thank you to everyone here today. Jolene and I are here today to present on behalf of Canada, and we're pleased to participate in your hearing today. We want to state first that we highly value the work and recommendations of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, which strengthen our ability to address human rights violations and help prevent them. As the Prime Minister of Canada, the Right Honourable Justin Trudeau, said on International Women's Day this year, violence against women is a violation of the most basic human rights. It destroys lives, tears families apart, it impacts entire communities, and has no place within our society. We could go to the first slide, please. Thank you. Our government, along with provinces and territories, has taken several steps of crucial importance to address the issue of violence against Indigenous women and girls. And I welcome this opportunity to share with the Commission an overview of these measures. Many of them give effect to the recommendations put forward in the Commission's report on missing and murdered Indigenous women in British Columbia. I also want to acknowledge the presence of the representatives of the Feminist Alliance for International Action and the Native Women's Association of Canada, and to thank them. The tireless efforts of these women to draw national and international attention to this issue were absolutely key in bringing about the national inquiry that I'm going to be speaking about today. Slide three, please. Thank you. Since the Commission finalized its report in 2014, Canada has held a federal election that has led to a change in the leadership of our government. Our federal government is committed to a renewed nation-to-nation relationship with Indigenous peoples based on recognition, rights, respect, cooperation, partnership, and to making real progress on issues like community safety, policing, housing, employment, health, child welfare, and education. The Government of Canada is also committed to renewing its engagement with international and regional human rights bodies. Last month, at a meeting of the United Nations Commission on the Status of Women, our Prime Minister, Trudeau, emphasized Canada's commitment to promote women's rights and gender equality, and acknowledged that Canada needs to do more to prevent violence against Indigenous women and girls. As this is a hearing into the missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls in Canada, in particular British Columbia, I wish to clearly state the Government of Canada's position is that the high rate of Indigenous women and girls who are murdered and missing in British Columbia and across our country is an ongoing national tragedy that must be addressed as a matter of priority. On December 8, 2015, Canada announced that our Minister of Indigenous and Northern Affairs, Minister of Justice, and Attorney General of Canada, supported by the Minister of the Status of Women, would launch an inquiry into missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls. An inquiry will seek recommendations on concrete actions that governments, police services, and others can take to address and prevent violence against Indigenous women and girls. I thank the Commission for its strong support of a nationwide inquiry. Canada's commitment to conduct the inquiry is an important part of the federal government's reconciliation efforts with Indigenous peoples and is part of Canada's commitment to renewing its dialogue with international and regional human rights bodies. The inquiry will be an important mechanism to examine and address the intergenerational trauma caused by the residential school system in Canada that operated from the 1870s until 1996. The examination of this link was a part of our Truth and Reconciliation Commission's call to action for the inquiry and was identified as an issue requiring study in your 2014 report. My colleague Jolene Head will now speak to the next few slides.
The Commission's report recommended the active participation of Indigenous women and non-governmental organizations in the design and implementation of initiatives, programs, and policies directed towards Indigenous women, including the inquiry. As a first step, a national pre-inquiry engagement process with survivors, families, loved ones, national Aboriginal organizations, provinces, and territories took place between December 2015 and February 2016. This type of direct engagement between cabinet ministers and family members was unprecedented in Canada. Approximately 2,160 people participated in 18 engagement sessions held from coast to coast to coast. 17 of the 18 meetings were primarily focused on survivors, family, loved ones, and frontline workers. The Government of Canada also provided funding to 5 national Indigenous organizations representing First Nations, Métis, and Inuit, including the Native Women's Association of Canada, to hold their own pre-inquiry engagement sessions and to develop submissions with recommendations regarding the design, scope, and mandate of the inquiry. The Paktudi Inuit Women of Canada and Women of the Métis Nation also received federal funding support for the pre-inquiry consultations. Receiving the input from these Indigenous organizations was a vital part of the pre-inquiry process. The pre-inquiry benefited from the input and expertise of the British Columbia Coalition on Murdered and Missing Women and Women and Girls. Our minister met with the coalition several times throughout the pre-inquiry process. Canada also received input from former commissioners, academics, Indigenous law experts, and domestic human rights experts. As the Commission and the United Nations Special Rapporteur here today are aware, our minister, the Minister of Justice and the Attorney General, and the Minister of Status of Women met with 6 United Nations and Inter-American Special Rapporteurs in February to hear their recommendations on the inquiry. All Canadians were also invited to provide their input. More than 4,100 online submissions and more than 200 letters and written submissions were received between December and February. As an Indigenous woman from Northern Manitoba, this issue is extremely important to me personally, and I was present at 17 of the 18 engagement sessions, and Margaret was also present at 6. Our minister, the Minister of Indigenous and Northern Affairs Canada, actively participated in 17 of those meetings. The Minister of Justice and Attorney General and the Minister of Status of Women each participated in a number of sessions as well. The Minister of Public Safety and Emergency Preparedness and the Minister of Canadian Heritage also attended meetings with family members, survivors, and loved ones. We heard deeply moving testimonies about violence and its devastating long-term effects on survivors, families, and the communities themselves. We admire their courage and learn so much from these strong people. Many of the key issues identified by the family members, loved ones, and survivors are well aligned with the recommendations previously put forward by the Commission. On public safety and justice, we heard the inquiry should examine police accountability, training, and protocols. Some participants called for missing persons and cold cases to be reopened, protocols for police communicating with families of the missing and murdered Indigenous women were also suggested. We also heard that the administration of justice needs to be reviewed for systemic racism and sexism. We heard the inquiry should explore links to historic policies and laws such as colonialism, the 60 Scoop, and the residential schools. The effects of current policies and laws, including the Indian Act, and programs such as child protection and housing were also identified by participants as requiring review. Similar to the recommendation of the Commission, we heard suggestions for the inquiry to look at funding levels for off and on reserve services. Several recommendations were put forward to the inquiry to honor the lives of missing and murdered women and girls, for example, such as erecting a monument in dedication to them. On the structure of the inquiry, we heard that Indigenous women and youth need to be involved throughout the entire process. We also heard that the inquiry should promote individual and community healing. Two of the 17 pre-inquiry design meetings with survivors, family members, loved ones, and frontline organizations took place in British Columbia in January and in Prince George. One was in Prince George and one was in Vancouver. Sorry. Again, many of the key issues identified by the participants are consistent with earlier Commission recommendations. A clear message heard at both the meetings was that the inquiry must respect and take into account cultural and regional differences among the Indigenous people in Canada. We heard a great deal about examining the specific challenges of Indigenous women in the two areas of particular concern studied in the Commission's report on Vancouver's downtown east side, which is Canada's poorest neighbourhood, and in the Highway 16 corridor, also known as the Highway of Tears. Participants in the Prince George session stressed the importance of making sure that survivors, families, and loved ones and frontline organizations are involved throughout the inquiry and the design of the inquiry itself. Participants in Vancouver said the inquiry should also include a feminist, sociological, and historical perspective. Some participants also said the inquiry should examine the root causes and consequences of sexual exploitation and trafficking of Indigenous women and girls. And I'll give it over to Margaret to finish.
The Commission and others have recommended better coordination amongst the different levels of government in Canada, and I'm pleased to inform the Commission that since the release of its report, there's been significant collaboration and coordination among the different levels of government to work on addressing and ending violence against Indigenous women and girls. In 2015, the first national roundtable was held in Ottawa. This roundtable brought together families of missing and murdered Indigenous women and girls, Indigenous representative organizations, all provinces and territories, and the federal government. It's a vital forum for governments to collaborate on this issue. Recently, at the second meeting of the National Roundtable in February 2016, all Canadian provinces and territories agreed to participate fully in the national inquiry. This agreement means that topics that could not be fully dealt with if it was just a federal inquiry will be able to be examined fully by the inquiry, such as provincial policing, housing, and child welfare. At the February National Roundtable, participants committed to continue with coordinated collaboration and action to prevent and address violence against Indigenous women during the national inquiry. Something we heard often during the pre-inquiry was that Canada should not wait until the inquiry is designed or far less completed to take action to address violence against Indigenous women and girls. As the inquiry is being designed, Canada continues to take action to confront violence against Indigenous women and girls. For example, the Government of Canada has committed to expand the existing network of shelters and transition houses to ensure that no survivor of family violence is left without a place to find shelter. The Government of Canada also funds community-driven proposals for family violence prevention projects, both on and off reserve. We've also launched a national public awareness campaign on the sex trafficking of Indigenous people. The The Royal Canadian Mounted Police remains committed to solving outstanding cases of missing and murdered Indigenous women. They have updated reporting policies and practices to ensure better data collection on the Indigenous origin of victims of violent crimes. This relates directly to this Commission's recommendation to improve data collection. The RCMP is engaging with provinces and territories, Indigenous groups, and other partners on national and locally tailored intervention and crime prevention programs. It is focusing its prevention and intervention efforts on family violence and youth empowerment to reduce violence against Indigenous women and girls. Moving forward, the Government of Canada has pledged to review existing gender and culturally sensitive training policies for federal frontline law enforcement officers to ensure that these are strong and effective. On law enforcement, the Prime Minister has mandated the Minister of Justice and our Attorney General of Canada to increase criminal penalties and bail conditions in cases involving domestic assault. The inquiry will lead to concrete recommendations for more actions in policing and justice areas. The 2016 federal budget proposes to invest $8.4 billion over 5 years, beginning this year, to improve the socioeconomic conditions of Indigenous peoples and their communities and bring about transformational change. This unprecedented scale of investment underscores the government's intent to renew the relationship with Indigenous peoples. Of note, there is a commitment to provide $40 million in funding for the National Inquiry. In addition, $96 million over 5 years and $10 million ongoing is proposed to support the capacity of Indigenous representative organizations to engage with our government. The 2016 budget provides $2.6 billion over 5 years for Indigenous primary and secondary education on reserves, $634.8 million over 5 years to strengthen First Nation child and family services, $100 million in 2017-18 towards early learning and child care, and significant funding for community infrastructure to improve housing and water. These investments will directly contribute to realizing the economic, social, and cultural rights of Indigenous peoples and be a step towards addressing some of the underlying issues that have been identified as contributing to violence against Indigenous women and girls. I'll expand on the investments to improve safety along the Highway 16 corridor from Prince Rupert to Prince George and efforts to improve policing, as these were both recommendations of this commission. At least 18 women and girls, many of them Aboriginal, have disappeared or murdered along Highway 16 in British Columbia and the adjacent routes Highways 5 and 97 since 1969. Investigations by civil society have found that this number could be almost twice as high. The province is taking steps to improve safety along the corridor, including committing $3 million to support a 5-point action plan to improve access to transportation services and security. On policing, the British Columbia government has taken steps to develop policing standards and to close jurisdictional gaps, both recommendations of the commission. Provincial legislation that will provide police with tools to help locate a missing person sooner has already been passed. In addition, the province is working to develop provincial policing standards on missing persons investigations. A long-term plan to address training recommendations related to bias-free policing and the treatment of vulnerable persons is under development. Looking ahead, the BC government supports and is committed to participating in a national inquiry. The province put forward a comprehensive submission to our pre-inquiry secretariat on the design of the inquiry, and this submission will be shared, as with all other submissions, to the inquiry so it can benefit from the lessons learned by the province. Across the country, provincial and territorial governments are taking action to combat violence against Indigenous women and girls. For example, in February 2016, the Ontario government announced a commitment of $100 million in new funding over 3 years. In the north, the Yukon Territory has provided $200,000 in funding to 5 culturally relevant initiatives designed and developed by and for Indigenous women as a key point in the strategy in taking collective action on violence against Indigenous women. Okay, Jean-Luc, merci. In 2015, the governments of Quebec and Ontario provided financial support for gatherings of loved ones of missing or murdered Indigenous women. Funding from the provinces enabled organizers of these events, the Quebec Native Women and the Chiefs of Ontario, to release reports recommending solutions. Manitoba has hosted national gatherings in September 2015 and in January 2016. And in the east, the government of Newfoundland and Labrador released the second phase of a violence prevention initiative last October. The actions that we have outlined demonstrate Canada's commitment to addressing the violence experienced by Indigenous women and girls. Ending this violence now and for future generations is a priority of the Government of Canada. Canada thanks the Commission for its report and recommendations and its leadership role on this issue. The Commission is a key partner in supporting Canada's efforts to meet its human rights obligations. It's never easy to talk about human rights violations in our own countries, but it is necessary. The promotion and protection of human rights is one of the cornerstones of the Organization of American States and the Inter-American System, one to which Canada is proud to contribute. Canada is committed to be a country where Indigenous women and girls can reach their full potential, and that starts with the basic right of security. We all benefit when women's and girls' human rights, including their economic, social, and cultural rights, are fully realized. We know that the families and loved ones and survivors of missing and murdered Indigenous women are counting on us not to wait for the public inquiry and to take immediate action wherever possible. The inquiry is an important part of our commitment to reconciliation with Indigenous peoples. Our minister has publicly expressed the desire is to have the inquiry begin its work by this summer. Before I conclude, I want to once again thank the representatives of the Native Women's Association of Canada and the Feminist Alliance for International Action for their unending efforts to bring this issue to the forefront. They have been instrumental in the effort to bring about a national inquiry that will lead to action that will help end the high rates of violence against Indigenous women and girls in our country. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the presentation. As I thank the other participants, we don't have much time. I'd like to present the opportunity to my colleagues on the table to raise questions, beginning with Second Vice President Margaret May McCauley, who is the Rapporteur for Women's Issues and Women's Rights for the Commission.
I must thank the civil society and the state for their presentations here this afternoon. As the president has mentioned, we do not have much time, which is very unfortunate for this very, very important issue. I will only ask a couple of questions, and one which I consider very important is this. Over the years, I know there have been amendments to the Indian Act, but the provision relating to sexual discrimination has repeatedly been overlooked. Could the state indicate why this continues to be a problem and when we can anticipate that it will be amended by removal from the provision? Such a provision should, in this day and age, should not be in any legislation. Could you also inform us what, in particular, are contained in the training manuals of the police when they open an investigation on a missing Indigenous person, or in fact, any woman at all, an Indigenous woman? Because that is, from that point, is when you make or break a case. And also is when you dishonor the dignity of the family and the person who has gone missing, as in fact the decisions of the court has highlighted in this particular, and decisions and recommendations of the commission. I've noted with great interest all that is going to be done, and we thank heavens for the new government's position in this regard. And we will monitor as we go along what in fact is implemented. But can I just ask in particular, I looked at on the documentation that we have, indigenous families who have come forward with missing reports of missing family members, what kind of support, in fact, are they given? Are they given counseling? Are they given therapeutic psychological assistance, apart from the financial and physical, which I expect would be given in any event? And could you tell us, in this large number of missing persons, how many of the perpetrators have, in fact, been identified and charged by the police? With that, I would leave questions for my colleagues here.
Thank you so much, Madam Vice President, Commissioner McCauley. Comisionado Iorin, por favor.
Gracias, Presidente. Sí, también. Rápido, por el problema del tiempo, he escuchado a las peticionarias plantear su expectativa de que con el nuevo gobierno, pues muchas de las recomendaciones de la comisión puedan ser implementadas y que se supere la situación existente. No obstante, como persona recién llegada a la comisión, pues este tema nos conmueve y uno se pregunta, ¿este tipo de situaciones han tenido una causa social, cultural, que a veces va más allá simplemente de medidas de remedio normativo? Yo quisiera saber de las peticionarias y del Estado en qué medida las causas que han generado esta situación se buscan atacar o se buscan revertir, entendiendo que una mayor seguridad, mejora del transporte y una capacitación va a ayudar al futuro. Pero pensando un poco en lo que pasó y que podría volver a ocurrir y que queremos que no pase, ¿cuál es la causa que está tras todo esto? Y eso lleva a algo que dijo también la comisionada McCauley. ¿Por qué? ¿Cómo explican que anteriormente no se haya hecho nada serio para enfrentar el problema, estando hablando de mujeres indígenas, de asesinatos y desapariciones, que son las manifestaciones más crueles en materia de derechos humanos? ¿Qué ha impedido enfrentar el problema y por qué, cómo remediar la impunidad de la cual se ha hablado en el tema de investigación, sanción y juzgamiento?
Thank you, Commissioner Higuerin. I omitted to mention that his rapporteur for the rights of indigenous peoples. Let me offer the la palabra al comisionado Enrique Gil Botero.
Gracias. En primer lugar, expresar el agradecimiento a los peticionarios y al Estado por su comparecencia. Como el objetivo de esta audiencia básicamente es el seguimiento de las recomendaciones formuladas al Estado, no voy a hacer preguntas, pero sí quiero destacar la actitud del Estado en el cumplimiento de esas recomendaciones que fueron formuladas. Se vienen cumpliendo y esperamos que se cumplan a cabalidad. Entonces, no hago preguntas, señor presidente, y destaco ese aspecto.
Madam Vice Secretary, I have a comment or two and a few questions, and I will be brief. First, it's been a long week. And so those who've been here this week will understand the nature of this comment. This is a real pleasure, this hearing, after this long week. That is to say, to be in a space in which there are disagreements. There's not perfect harmony among all the parties, but I think there's a recognition that the state is moving in the right direction, that it's recognized the gravity of the situation, that it's establishing a mechanism, which was one of the primary recommendations of this body, of the special rapporteur in her CEDAW role and of other UN organizations or entities that have addressed this issue. And obviously for the Commission, it is of great consequence that there is this openness, this willingness to recognize the gravity, to look forward and backward both at the same time with the inquiry, with a series of recommendations, and with actions taken as the inquiry moves forward. So let me just underscore that, and of course recognize the presence of the Special Rapporteur of great significance for the Commission, as is the presence of leading advocates who I had the privilege of spending 2 days with in Ottawa quite recently. So thank you all for this debate. This is a continuing debate. We hope very much to be able to contribute and to be present. We thank all the parties for the interest in engaging with the Commission, both in this space and beyond. So I will be brief and just raise 3 questions and offer the floor to each of the 3 parties. If I could identify 3 of the many issues in quite broad strokes, and I'd be curious to, after having heard the position of the government on these 3 issues, to get your feedback both now and moving forward. The one question involves federal versus national. And I heard some responses about ways in which this will be federal. To what extent do those concerns or those manifestations accord with your expectations? The second issue, that as I understand Prime Minister Trudeau's comments about the nation-to-nation relationship that he will and the state will forge moving forward vis-a-vis First Nations, Indigenous peoples in Canada. Is there tension between that that approach and the need to work not only with male-led Aboriginal organizations, but with organizations of women? So I think there may be to some extent, and how can that be overcome? There's a third issue that I can't find in my notes, but it must be important, and I will raise it, and I'll tell you when I will raise it with you. I will be in Ottawa, fortunately, happily, in the first week in May, and I welcome the opportunity to continue this dialogue with all present in whatever fora or makes sense. In that opportunity, I will communicate this fact. I expect to meet with Ambassador Lowton and others in the coming week and to be in touch with the civil society members here. I don't know if we will have the fortune of counting on your presence in Ottawa in the near future, but of course, always a welcome interest in speaking, hearing your views. So with that, let me conclude. What we can do here is to provide 2 minutes, 2 minutes and 3 minutes for some observations and offer the opportunity to continue informing the Commission in writing and in other meetings about these very important topics. So if we can begin with 2 minutes with the petitioning party.
Okay, Sharon McIver, I'll address the First Nations male-led organizations and the primary one in Canada is the Assembly of First Nations. And from the perspective is that the Assembly of First Nations is the chiefs that are elected for each of their individual communities. And the rules set down for election of chiefs and that is all government, Canadian government legislation that puts that up, and from the perspective of many of us, it's actually the chiefs are actually an arm of the Canadian government, and so they're basically the primary input is from the Assembly of First Nations, which is only the elected chiefs of the individual bands, and some of the bands, many of the bands, actually have a traditional council in place that is not recognized by the government of Canada. And the funding for the Assembly of First Nations is from the Government of Canada. And so our history has it in every incident where the Aboriginal women have tried to call Canada to account for the discrimination and the removal from our reserves of the women who married out, and that the Assembly of First Nation and other male-led or male-dominated Aboriginal organizations has stood in between us and the government on the government side.
Thank you. Madam Special, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
And traditionally, we're the majority of First Nations in Canada are matrilineal societies, where women had a role as community leaders and community input and family leaders and cultural leaders. And so that's being dismissed or not recognized.
Thank you. Madam Special Rapporteur.
Thank you. I don't have answers. I have only questions, so I will skip. Thank you.
I appreciate the honesty, as always. Delegation of Canada, please.
Thank you very much. And once again, we very much appreciate this exchange, and I won't waste my time saying what I think we all know to be a fact, and we very much welcome our ongoing engagement with the Commission on this and any other issue. I've taken careful note of the questions from all of the commissioners, and they're excellent. What I propose that we do is to give them due consideration, and I would point out that there are a number of government departments engaged on this issue, and we would want to ensure that our answer is comprehensive and fully reflects, and we will do as we have done in the past and provide a full written submission to the Commission in response. I would also note, I took careful note of the question raised by our representatives of civil society with respect to paragraph 106 of the Commission's report, and we will also look into that and return to the respondents on that particular matter. I took hasty notes, and I will follow up and make sure that we do get that information and we do cover those issues. Dialogue is extremely important, open and frank, and that the government provide the answers that are asked of us. We welcome this opportunity to engage with the Commission and with representatives of civil society. And once again, Commissioner Cavallo, I welcome an opportunity to meet with you at your convenience. Thank you.
My colleague, my sister, reminds me that she is also the rapporteur for racial discrimination, another topic before us today. Let me thank you all, and again, dialogue, as the ambassador has said, is essential. We hope to be involved in that dialogue moving forward. Let me thank the special rapporteur for her presence. Let me thank the representatives of civil society for your presence, your information. And with that, call a close to this hearing.